He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave Explains.
Hey guys, I wanted to show you some more stuff with ChemDoodle. This time I wanted to use the 3D software rather than the 2D software that I've shown you a couple of times previously. And I wanted to use this one because it's really great for visualizing molecules in three dimensions. So what I want to use this for today is to build upon what we've already learned about VSEPR theory and molecular geometry. So if you haven't seen my first tutorial on this in the general chemistry playlist, go ahead and check that out because that's sort of the basics about VSEPR theory. And now I want to use, build on that and use this software to talk a little bit about bond angles and also some of the molecular geometries that we didn't talk about before. So just to show you what this thing can do, here's methane, and I've drawn this the way we might on a piece of paper, just with a C and some H's. And of course, we know that that doesn't accurately represent the geometry. So what I want to show you here is the way that we can actually use this software to show us what the correct geometry of any molecule is going to be. So we can go over here to optimize and use this minimization option. And that is going to use the rules of chemistry to go ahead and calculate what the geometry of the molecule must be. So this looks like it makes a lot more sense, right? This is what methane looks like. We know that this carbon atom is sp3 hybridized, and therefore it's going to adopt this tetrahedral geometry. And we can drag this around and get everything looking, you know, look at it from all angles so that it's not just a three-dimensional representation on a piece of paper. We really can turn this all around and make sure that the shape feels really intuitive in our minds. And another thing that we can also do is verify some bond angles. So we can use this tool over here. So let's select these three atoms, and we can see 109.47, that's about 109.5, which is exactly what we expect for a molecule that has tetrahedral electron domain geometry and molecular geometry, as there are no lone pairs there. Just to show one other thing here that's kind of fun, we can turn auto-optimize on. So if we turn that on, that is going to ensure that if we want to manipulate this molecule in any way, it is going to stay optimized. So I can drag this around by the carbon atom. I can drag this around by one of the hydrogen atoms. And we can see that it will always retain the same geometry and the same bond angles. Okay, so that is methane. Now, I want to talk about some of the other molecular geometries. We know that within any electron domain geometry, there can be multiple molecular geometries. So what if we change this to a nitrogen, and then let's get rid of a hydrogen? Okay, so that's ammonia. We've got NH3. Now, the thing is, just by deleting that hydrogen and changing this to a nitrogen, this may not be the precise correct geometry. So let's go ahead and optimize again. Okay, so we have optimized, and let's go ahead and turn auto optimization on as well, just to make sure this stays correct. And now we can drag this around and we can see this geometry because we know that the nitrogen has a lone pair. So we're gonna have to visualize that lone pair right here, because nitrogen has 5 valence electrons. So 3, 1 goes to each covalent bond, and then there's a lone pair left over. So that's why we get this trigonal pyramidal looking situation. And now let's go ahead and calculate the bond angles. So we've got 108.12. I've seen this as low as 107, but ballpark, it's correct. And the thing that's important to understand is that this is less than what we saw for methane, right? Now, and the reason for that is because of the enhanced repulsion that is offered by a lone pair. So this lone pair up here is going to repel the other groups more so than a covalent bond to another hydrogen atom would. So we do want to keep that in mind when assessing molecular geometry and bond angles. Lone pairs will repel neighboring electron density more than a covalent bond to a hydrogen atom, so or any atom. So for methane, we saw 109.5. For ammonia, with that one lone pair, we're seeing about 108. So let's continue this trend. Why don't we go ahead and turn this into an oxygen, and then let's get rid of one more hydrogen. Okay, so we've got water, we've got H2O there. And let's optimize again because once again, the bond angles are going to change slightly. So we do have to re-optimize in order to get this correct. And again, let's turn auto-optimize on. And now we can look at this and it looks a little bit different, right? We can see that this is a little bit different than ammonia. We do see the bent shape, right? We see that bent shape very clearly because oxygen now has two lone pairs, one going away from us, one going towards us to retain that tetrahedral electron domain geometry, but the shape is going to be bent. And once again, we can get these bond angles, and we might predict that it's going to be even less than for ammonia because we have now two lone pairs that are repelling, and they're going to repel these hydrogen atoms more so than we saw for methane or even ammonia. So now we see about 104.5. So that is now significantly less than the 109.5 that we saw for methane. So that's what we want to understand. Now, we already looked at methane, ammonia, and water in my previous VSEPR tutorial. I did want to talk about these bond angles. That is important. So now let's go ahead and look at some other electron domain geometries and some of the molecular geometries that we didn't talk about. Let's put a phosphorus and let's do PCl5. So we've got a phosphorus atom and we've got five chlorine atoms. And we've drawn that however we wish. And let's go ahead and minimize. And that is going to be our geometry for PCl5. So we can clearly see that this has adopted a trigonal bipyramidal molecular geometry, right? We can see this triangular plane and then the pyramids extending on either side. So clearly, the phosphorus atom is sp3d hybridized, right? And that's because it's got five valence electrons, and so we need one valence electron for each of the five bonds, and this is the furthest away that these five groups can be. And this is an interesting electron domain geometry because it is the one that has two different bond angles. We've got 90-degree bond angles here, but within the plane of this triangle, we've got 120-degree bond angles. So it's kind of like trigonal planar and linear combined. So that's an interesting one. Now let's make some modifications just like before so we can talk about some of these other ways this can be. So what if we go ahead and get rid of one of these? Let's turn this into sulfur, and then let's turn these into fluorines. So now we have SF4. Okay, we have SF4. Let's get the right geometry there. So that's what this is going to look like. And if we turn this thing around, we can see that it's still very similar, right? But the difference is that we're missing this group over here because this is occupied by a lone pair, right? SF6 sulfur has six valence electrons, so four of them go to create these covalent bonds, and then we have a lone pair right there. Okay? And this is called a seesaw shape. This has seesaw molecular geometry, which makes sense if we kind of look at it like this, right? It's like a seesaw. It's kind of like right, this is one kid sitting here, one kid sitting there, and that can go like that. So that's what we mean by seesaw. And so that's one way that we can do that. Now let's continue here. So why don't we go ahead and get rid of one of these, another one of these, and let's turn that into chlorine. So ClF3 actually is a molecule that works. So let's go ahead and optimize that. So this is what we get, and we call this T-shaped. So this is still sp3d hybridized. We know that chlorine has seven valence electrons, and so it's going to use three to make these covalent bonds, and then it has two lone pairs left over, right? Four, five, six, seven. Those are going to occupy these locations that were occupied by atoms in the original electron domain geometry, right? When we had PCl5. So we've gone from trigonal bipyramidal to seesaw to T-shaped. Okay? And if we got rid of one more, we could get linear. So sp3d has a variety of molecular geometries within the overall electron domain geometry of trigonal bipyramidal. So the orientation of all the groups is the same, but it's interesting what happens as we start to replace atoms with lone pairs. Okay, so that's that. Let's go ahead and try, let's put a sulfur atom. And let's do SF6. So once again, we can draw that however we want. We're just putting six fluorine atoms on a sulfur atom. And let's go ahead and minimize here. And there is the octahedral geometry that we would expect. So let's zoom in there. Okay, so that is what we're looking at. This perfectly symmetrical situation, that is octahedral, and any of these four, right, we can see this as sort of the square base, and then we can put the pyramid up there, the pyramid up there. So it's like two square pyramids fused together. So that's octahedral. Now let's change this a little bit. Let's get rid of one of these fluorines, and let's turn this into bromine. Okay, so we've got BrF5 now. And let's make sure that this is looking correct. And so this is an interesting situation. We actually did not see this in my previous tutorial. This is called square pyramidal. Right, so this is square pyramidal because we've got, so bromine has seven valence electrons, and so it's gonna use five of them for these five covalent bonds. But then 7 minus 5, we've got 2 left over. That's going to be this lone pair down here. So that is going to repel the electron density just as a bond to an atom would, and we're going to retain this overall configuration. So this is square pyramidal, and we're looking at sp3d2 hybridized complexes. So SF6 was sp3d2, and so is BrF5 with that lone pair. 5 atoms, 1 lone pair, 6 electron domains overall. And let's go ahead and do one more. So let's get rid of one more atom and let's change this to xenon. So this is a xenon atom, and now we didn't maybe necessarily even know that some noble gases can make covalent bonds. Xenon can because it's large enough. So let's go ahead and minimize that again. And we can very clearly see our square planar configuration here. So this is very interesting because it looks like it would be incorrect. Just the way that when we draw methane like this, it's incorrect. Because methane, there are only 4 electron domains. And so that's an sp3 hybridization. That's got to be tetrahedral. But now xenon tetrafluoride, xenon has 8 valence electrons. Remember, it's got its valence shell full. So it has 8 valence electrons. It's going to use 4 for these 4 covalent bonds. But then it has 2 lone pairs left over. And because of the way those repel each other, those will prefer to be directly opposite one another rather than, say, one here and one here. With just a 90 degree angle, those lone pairs, because they repel even more so than these atoms, they're going to want to have a 180 degree, they're going to want to be completely opposite each other. So this is the correct geometry. It's not for methane, but it is for xenon tetrafluoride because of those additional lone pairs. So this is the square planar molecular geometry for an overall octahedral electron domain geometry that we get when we replace 2 atoms with 2 lone pairs. So that's it. I just wanted to cover some of these molecular geometries we didn't talk about previously. So for sp3d, that was our seesaw and our T-shaped, and then eventually getting to linear. And then for the sp3d2, we also saw we saw square pyramidal. And we also saw square planar. So that's just to show you some of these additional geometries and just help you visualize. Once again, we are using ChemDoodle 3D to do this, which is tremendously helpful. Once again, you can construct any molecule you want. You can go over here and build it with carbon atoms, or you can input whatever other elements you want, and then just go ahead and optimize it, and it'll show you what the geometry must be for a small molecule or a large one as well. And so that's the ChemDoodle 3D. I've also shown you ChemDoodle 2D in the past, and those can come together as a bundle. It's called iChem Labs. So iChem Labs produces both of these softwares, and they're very affordable and very useful for a variety of purposes, whether you're in general chemistry or organic chemistry or any other chemistry course. So I definitely encourage you to check those out, and I'll see you guys next time.
Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.